Okay, the final item of business is a members' business debate on motion 4277 in the name of Beatrice Wishart on protecting marine life during unexploded ordnance removal. This debate will be concluded without any questions being put. I'd invite members who wish to participate to press the request to speak buttons now or as soon as possible, and I call on Beatrice Wishart to open the debate for around about 7 minutes, Ms. Wishart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and thank you to members for taking an interest in this debate tonight. I also thank the Minister for attending on behalf of the Scottish Government and would like to thank her for her time when we met a few weeks ago to discuss this matter. Whether through the provision of food, energy or fascinating wildlife, the coast and seas of Scotland have for centuries been bountiful. As we continue to expand the use of our seas, we are met with increasingly difficult challenges that not only risk human lives, but the very environment we rely on. There are an estimated 500,000 unexploded ordnance items, or UXOs, in waters around the UK, many in the areas designated for offshore wind farms. These munitions have posed a risk for decades, with numerous examples of unexploded bombs, torpedoes and shells being hauled up in fishing nets. And I well remember an incident many years ago when a trawler hauled up a torpedo off Fair Isle and came into Lerwick Harbour. And I'm sure the crew of the Lerwick lifeboat remember it too, because two fishermen were lost as a consequence of dragging up a torpedo. As we continue to build more infrastructure at sea to help meet our net zero targets, the seabed must also be surveyed and cleared. And encountering these UXOs increases the risk to us and the environment. And they're usually cleared by high-order detonations, where a countercharge is placed next to the unexploded munitions, and both are exploded, creating a large underwater blast. High-order detonations are thought to be responsible for affecting the auditory system of marine animals. And this can impact animals up to 30 kilometres away from a blast. The explosions also leave craters in the seabed, where the remnants of toxins and explosives scatter through the water and can enter the food chain. But, Presiding Officer, there are alternatives to high-order detonations at sea, and militaries and navies across the world use low-order detonation by deflagration processes. Indeed, the Royal Navy has used the technology since the early 2000s. The alternative low-order detonation is less disruptive, reduces acoustic output by 20 decibels, and the affected area reduced to 750 metres. And after the UXO is made safe, what is left can be removed from the seabed by remotely operated underwater vehicles. The Scottish Government is awaiting analysis from a Danish Navy trial of low-order deflagration, which was conducted earlier this year. And I would be grateful if the Minister could let us know in her closing remarks what the timeline is for the findings to be known, and if policy changes are envisioned, how long they will take to put in place. I became an orca species champion when I was elected in 2019, and I'm pleased to say I continue to be their champion in this Parliament. We learn more about these fascinating animals and other marine mammals every day, not least through the many reports on Shetland Orca Sightings Facebook page. What we do know is that marine mammals rely heavily on their auditory systems and that they're intelligent and social creatures. Harm to these auditory systems can disrupt navigation, feeding and communication, while noise trauma can cause permanent hearing loss and is thought to be responsible for leading to mass strandings. Yes?
Liam Kerr.
I'm very grateful. I'm enjoying the member's contribution. Can the member tell me, has anyone studied the impact of exploding ordnance on commercial fish stocks or spawning grounds, is she aware? And in any event, would the minister address this in closing?
Beatrice Wishart.
Well, I think there is concern, although I have focused this debate primarily on orcas and cetaceans. A report into the 2011 incident at the Kyle of Durness, where 39 long-finned pilot whales became stranded, led to 19 deaths and revealed that noise from munition disposal operations in the area at the time was the probable cause of the strandings and deaths. As we see the stress climate change is placing on our natural environment, is it not our responsibility to ensure that as we develop more at sea to tackle the climate crisis, we also ensure that same expansion is not further damaging populations of marine mammals and other sea life. Could the Minister confirm if it's the Scottish Government's intention to end the use of all high-order detonations for UXOs discovered? I appreciate that emergency situations can suddenly arise, but new ways of clearance should be the preference for the environment and human safety every time. I believe the Minister is aware of my concerns about ensuring Marine Scotland is well resourced in order to carry out its pivotal role in safeguarding what happens in our seas. Along with many other responsibilities, the body issues licences for the clearance of unexploded munitions in Scottish waters. Will it be able to fill this role, as well as ensuring that those with licences are using the least damaging methods? If Marine Scotland is busy now, and with offshore wind developments rapidly advancing, how can the government ensure that it's keeping pace with developments and new technologies, as well as ensuring enforcement of UXO licences in real time? Transparency is vital in a regulated approach to new technologies, and without it, how do we advance or improve them? The expectation of the Scottish Government and other UK regulators who signed up to the joint position statement last November is that developers prioritise low noise methods, but that statement is non-binding. I believe Scotland could lead the way and be at the forefront of new industries and the associated novel techniques to mitigate impacts to Scotland's marine environment. I'd be keen to work with the Scottish Government to create a position that is binding and enforceable to help protect sea life and marine mammals. In concluding, Presiding Officer, I would like to thank the Stop Sea Blast campaign for their assistance and for coming to Parliament last month to hold an event to highlight this important topic. And I'd like to thank the MSPs who came along to find out about UXOs and their impact on the marine environment. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much, Ms. Wishart. We now move to the open debate. I call first Emma Harper to be followed by Finlay Carson for around 4 minutes. Ms. Harper.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I welcome the opportunity to speak in this debate and congratulate Beatrice Wishart on securing it. Increasing development in the marine environment is leading to the discovery of a greater number of undetonated munitions. Clearance of unexploded ordnance is commonly undertaken by high-order detonation, as Beatrice Wishart described. It's a controlled explosion, it leads to loud blasts, and it disturbs protected marine mammals. And I agree with Beatrice Wishart that these blasts cause a huge welfare concern to marine life and to our natural marine environment. Presiding Officer, since 2019, I've been raising my concerns over levels of unexploded ordnance, which is washing ashore across beaches and coastal areas in Dumfries and Galloway. And although exact figures aren't available, the Coast Guard and the Royal Navy Bomb Disposal Unit have reported that the number of unexploded ordnance washing ashore is increasing. And while the exact reasons for this remain unclear, there is expert opinion which suggests that it may be due to a combination of sea levels rising, increasing offshore projects, such as the construction of offshore wind projects, and increased marine traffic. Presiding Officer, Beaufort's Dyke is a national deep water trench located in the North Channel of the Irish Sea between Ireland and Port Patrick in the southwest of Scotland. It is also widely understood that at the end of the Second World War, instead of taking the surplus unexploded munitions to dump them directly in Beaufort's Dyke, which was approved as a dump site, often the weapons were dumped outside or around the dyke site to save money and time. It is therefore a little wonder that we are now discovering more unexploded ordnance washing ashore. Presiding Officer, according to the MOD, over 50,000 tonnes of explosives are disposed of in Beaufort's Dyke, just off the coast in the Irish Sea, and in July 1945 alone, 14,500 tonnes of 5-inch, 130mm artillery rockets filled with phosgene gas were dumped. And in addition, according to documents from the Public Records Office, approximately 2 tonnes of concrete-encased metal drums filled with radioactive laboratory waste and luminous paint were dumped in the dyke during the 1950s. I have previously contacted the UK Government's Secretaries of State for Scotland and the Secretary of State for Defence to ask whether a risk assessment of the stability of Beaufort's Dyke and around the site has been carried out, so that constituents across the region can be assured of its safety. And I've sought assurance that there are no future plans to use the dyke site as a dump site in the future. Unsurprisingly, other than one response from the MOD indicating that they believe Beaufort's Dyke is to be safe and it poses no threat. I have had no response from the Scottish or Defence Secretaries and therefore repeat my calls for Beaufort's Dyke to receive a full safety inspection. This would not only reassure constituents, it would also protect our marine environment, as RSPB's Director Anne McCall has herself shared concerns over the impact of undersea explosions on sea life. Alternatives to high-order detonation are now available to the commercial market. Some have developed in a military context, or they've been developed in a military context but not used commercially, while others have been developed purely for industry use. These alternatives do require the use of explosive material to effect clearance, but in much smaller volumes compared to the donor charges required for high-order detonation. Alternative methods cause lower noise levels, including reducing the impacts to the marine environment. And I agree with Beatrice Wishart that their use is welcome, and I would ask the Minister to do all she can to press the UK Government to make use of these alternatives as standard practice. Presiding Officer, in closing, I repeat my calls on the UK Government to carry out a full safety inspection of Beaufort's Dyke and ask the Minister to press the UK Government to use proven alternatives to high-order detonation as well. So thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much, Ms Harper. And I call Finlay Carson to be followed by Mercedes Villalba for around 4 minutes, Mr Carson.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And can I also thank Beatrice Wishart for bringing this matter to the Chamber and giving Parliament the opportunity to speak on the subject. We absolutely should do all we can to protect the welfare of our marine wildlife, which is subject to so many challenges at this time, including from the impact of unexploded bombs. As we've heard, it's estimated that there's around 100,000 tonnes of ordnance in UK waters, equating to almost 500,000 bombs, mines and shells left over from the First and Second World Wars. Interestingly and worryingly, much of this ordnance lies buried in areas that are now being designated for potential offshore wind construction, something that the Scottish Government is anxious to develop and expand in the coming years if we are to meet net zero emission targets. So it's welcome news that some wind farm developers and energy companies are seeking alternative methods to clear unexploded ordnance, and many require contractors to offer low-order deflagration as a process which can burn out a bomb and the likes without detonation. In this process, a magnesium cone is fired at the munition, causing explosive content to ignite and burn out from within without a damaging explosion, which results in significantly lower noise emissions. It's a largely unknown fact that noise levels are only dependent on the size of the countercharge and not on the size of the explosive tested. However, low order is not standard practice, and the high order method is still commonly used. Of course, it's worth mentioning that marine planning and protection is a devolved matter to the Scottish Government, which means that if it falls within the responsibility of ministers in Scotland to regulate on this issue, and the use of explosives within the UK marine licensing area requires a licence under the Marine and Coastal Access Act 2009, Part 4. In Scotland, the body responsible for licensing is Marine Scotland. In November 2021, Marine Scotland signed a joint position statement which included the line, low noise alternatives to high order detonations should be prioritised when developing protocols to clear UXOs. However, as we've already heard, it's non-binding, and high order techniques or similar still very likely to continue to be used to clear unexploded ordnance. And I recognise the significant impact underwater noise from ordnance clearance can have on vulnerable marine species, which means we have to tackle this matter delicately and with great care. And campaigners such as Stop Sea Blast Groups, the Stop Sea Blast Group have rightly highlighted this. As I understand it, Crown Estates Scotland operates under a framework document set out by the Scottish Government, and amongst other responsibility, manages and leases the seabed within 12 nautical miles of Scotland. In undertaking surveys of potential sites for offshore and wind development, I know that unexploded munitions are often found, which need to be cleared. But to clear such munitions, developers must apply for a licence from Marine Scotland, and specialist companies are then hired to carry out the work within the terms of the licence granted. I think we should all agree that any clearance method used has to be safe and effective without causing any damage to marine wildlife. The UK Government supports the development and use of lower noise alternatives than the high-order detonation, which is a traditional method. And this is something that campaigners want to see happen in Scottish waters as well. The decision to prioritise the use of low-noise alternatives is, I believe, a welcome step forward and something I hope the Scottish Government will take into future considerations. It is previously said it is awaiting the results of trials conducted by the Danish Navy before deciding on any future legislation. And while it is important that all scientific data is taken into account, it is clear that there are alternatives such as low-order detonation, which can reduce noise output by several hundred times compared to the large blast, should be encouraged. Everything possible should and must be done to protect our marine wildlife and environment as a matter of course, in order to avoid a repeat of the incident that we are aware of with the Kyle of Durness in July 2011, when 19 whales died. We must do as much as we can as soon as possible. Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much, Mr Carson. I now call Mercedes Villalba to be followed by Maggie Chapman. Around 4 minutes, Ms Villalba.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'd like to thank Beatrice Wishart for securing this important debate today on protecting marine life during unexploded ordnance removal. I also want to pay tribute to the work that Stop Sea Blasts continues to do to raise awareness of this issue, including the informative event that they held in Parliament last month. It's clear that the scale of this issue should not be underestimated. As a result of the two world wars, there is now over 100,000 tonnes of unexploded ordnance in the UK's waters. And as we continue to develop our offshore energy infrastructure, there'll be a greater need to remove unexploded ordnance from the seabed. But as we've already heard, unexploded ordnance is currently removed in a highly disruptive way to marine life and habitats, due to the use of high-order detonations. As others have already explained, this is having a particularly harmful effect on marine mammals who rely on sound for navigation, communication, and feeding. And it's not just wildlife that is affected. The use of these high-order detonations also harms marine habitats, with explosives leaving craters in the seabed and damaging the sea floor. So that's why we must urgently look at the use of low-order technologies in unexploded ordnance removal so that we can protect marine life and habitats. We know that these low-order technologies work. A UK government-funded study found that low-order technologies reduce both noise emissions and physical damage to the seabed. And crucially, these technologies are supported by a range of marine protection organisations like Whale and Dolphin Conservation. So given the damage caused by high-order detonations and the evidence of viable alternatives, I believe the time is now for concrete action from the Scottish Government and Marine Scotland. The Scottish Government has a national marine plan. This should be updated to include support for a shift to the use of low-order technologies in unexploded ordnance removal. Marine Scotland has signed up to a UK-wide regulatory statement. This signals a shift towards favouring the use of low-order technologies, but it needs to be made binding. And Marine Scotland already has licensing conditions for ordnance removal, but they are outdated. So these conditions must be updated to ensure that developers prioritise the use of low-order technologies and ensure high-order detonations are subject to tighter restrictions. But, Presiding Officer, I believe there's another issue which must also be addressed through a change to licensing conditions. Most unexploded ordnance removal work is carried out by private companies on behalf of offshore developers. Given the risks associated with the use of high-order detonations and the removal of unexploded ordnance, I believe there should be a clear obligation on employers to guarantee workers' rights and safety. So I'm calling on the Scottish Government and Marine Scotland to commit to exploring the introduction of a new marine licensing condition which ensures employers adhere to established employment rights and health and safety legislation. Presiding Officer, today's debate relates to the role that Marine Scotland plays in managing our seas. So I would like to conclude by touching upon an ongoing dispute involving its fisheries protection fleet. Up to 80 Marine Scotland workers face the prospect of having a below-inflation 2% pay rise imposed on them by the Scottish Government. As Unite the Union have highlighted, imposing a pay award against the wishes of a workforce could constitute an illegal inducement and leave the Scottish Government in breach of collective bargaining arrangements. So as well as taking the urgent action needed on the issue of unexploded ordnance removal, the Scottish Government must also engage with Unite and the Marine Scotland workers to deliver the fair pay rise that they deserve.
Thank you, Ms Villalba. And I call the final speaker in the open debate, Maggie Chapman, for around 4 minutes, Ms Chapman.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'd like to thank Beatrice Wishart very much for lodging this important motion and securing this afternoon's debate. I'd also like to thank her for hosting the parliamentary event on this topic last month. I was not able to make that, but I did have some very interesting and helpful follow-up conversations with EODEX and others about the Stop Sea Blasts campaign. Hearing about the pretty catastrophic impacts on cetaceans and other marine life that most current commercial disposal mechanisms have, and the alternatives, proven low-order deflagration that Beatrice and others have so clearly described. I appreciate that in this chamber, we are used to, or at least getting a little more used to, a fair amount of noise and disruption during business. Sometimes some of us might struggle to hear because of this disruption, but mostly we deal with it. Now, imagine if we used our auditory systems for navigation, for communication, for feeding, for staying alive. Without the system, we would be completely cut off from our fellow creatures. We could not eat, we could not travel anywhere safely. In fact, we'd have no idea where we were, what dangers or threats were nearby, or anything about our surroundings. We would be, essentially, helplessly vulnerable. What if we were near an explosion that took out our auditory system completely? Within 2 kilometres of the blast, it's almost certain that we'd die because of the pressure waves caused by the explosion. Research shows a complete kill zone of between 0 and 50 metres, but an almost certain death zone of up to 2 kilometres from the blast site. Up to 10 kilometres away, we'd suffer permanent threshold shift, PTS, or permanent damage to our hearing. Up to 20 kilometres away, we'd suffer temporary threshold shift, TTS, temporary hearing damage. But that might be enough to distort our feeding and communication to such an extent that the trauma is overwhelming and the consequences result in permanent damage. Beyond 20 kilometres, there may still be some long-term behavioural impacts as a consequence of the trauma. To put this in perspective, if we were all cetaceans in this chamber today, a blast at Haymarket Station would kill us. A blast at Edinburgh Airport would render us all with permanent hearing loss. We would become disoriented, hungry, traumatised. We would likely die. And this is exactly what happened to the 19 pilot whales who beached themselves and died at Carle of Durness, as Beatrice Wishart and others have highlighted. We have a responsibility to act, to ensure that we are not complicit in the deaths of cetaceans and other sea life, to ensure that we do not just stand by and accept the release of toxins and the destruction of our seabeds that result from high-order deflagration. I'm interested to hear what the Minister will say in her closing, and in addition to the questions and points raised by others this evening, I hope she will provide an update on what requirements the Scottish Government is able to make of BP, Shell, SSE and other energy operators who undertake deflagration in Scottish waters now, especially in the North Sea or off the North East Coast. This is perhaps especially important given the ScotWind licences these companies have and the work they need to do in preparation for the development of the offshore wind farms. As part of this, I'd also ask the Minister what, if any, plans there are in place to ensure that proven alternatives to high-order deflagration will be used. The Stop Sea Blasts campaign and others are clear. So-called low-yield deflagration is not the same. It must be low-order deflagration, and it must be proven to work, not hypothetical. In closing, Presiding Officer, I'd like once again to thank Beatrice Wishart for bringing this important topic to the Chamber, and thank the Stop Sea Blasts campaigners for all they are doing to raise awareness and act to protect our marine species and ecosystems. Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed, Ms Chapman. I now call on Mary McCallum to respond to the debate minister for around about 7 minutes, please.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer, and my thanks as well to Beatrice Wishart for lodging this motion on what her and I both agree is an important topic. As she said, Ms Wishart and I met to discuss the issue some weeks ago, and I know it's one she cares very much about and is campaigning for, and I was sorry I wasn't able to make the parliamentary event regarding it. Thanks also to members for their contributions this afternoon, many of which have focused on the importance of a healthy marine environment. The Scottish Government's vision for our marine environment is a clean, healthy, safe, productive and diverse one, which is managed to meet the long-term needs of nature and of people. And as members have pointed to today, Presiding Officer, our marine environment is increasingly important to our environmental, social and economic well-being. We must manage this increasingly busy space fairly and, crucially, safely. And I think Ms Wishart referred to how dangerous this challenge can be, indeed fatal in some circumstances. We know that offshore wind in particular will be critical in our journey to net zero. We must seize the opportunity for our climate and for our green economy of the future. But we must do so in a way that protects our waters, our marine wildlife, and which ensures the health and safety of maritime workers, as Mercedes Villalba rightly pointed to. Now, as members have said, the vast majority of unexploded ordnance is discovered when offshore wind developers come to prepare their sites for development. They have to be safely disposed of to allow construction works to commence. It has to be effective, it has to be safe, and it must be as environmentally unobtrusive as possible. I know Liam Kerr asked about commercial fisheries. I will focus my remarks on offshore wind, as the motion does, but I'd like to reassure him that licence conditions do require that if any dead fish are reported from the activity, that this comes and is reported straight back to Marine Scotland. So we're taking action to meet those objectives of safety and effectiveness. We do this through licensing processes and by collaborative working with other regulators and statutory nature conservation bodies. And I'd like to highlight exactly what the Scottish Government is doing today, as a number of members have asked me to. So as regards licensing, in line with policies set out in our National Marine Plan, we are committed to reducing the effects of man-made noise and vibration on marine species, especially those which are sensitive to such effects. Before starting any UXO clearance on an offshore wind farm site, a developer must apply to Marine Scotland for both a marine licence and for a European protected species licence. These two licensing regimes are underpinned by legislation, and they require offshore wind developers to use UXO clearance methods which produce the least underwater noise. When applying for these licences, developers must consider any satisfactory alternatives to meet their objectives of clearance, and these must have the least environmental impact. And to further reinforce that commitment, the licences that we issue contain those binding conditions that I have been asked about, which mean that all possible opportunities to undertake UXO clearance using low-noise techniques must have failed before licences can consider the use of a higher-order detonation. And of course, we know that as evidence develops, higher-order detonation is still sometimes required for human safety reasons, although we are watching as evidence develops on that. But this robust framework that I've set out today, I hope, will give members assurance that low-noise techniques are prioritised where practicable, where effective and where safe. And beyond what we're doing in the licensing space, we are collaborating. We know that to meet the challenge of reducing underwater noise resulting from increased development in the marine environment, that we must work with other regulators and statutory nature conservation bodies. And we must do this to support the use of alternatives to high-order detonation. That is all of our goal. That's why, together with colleagues in DEFRA, in BAES, in the Marine Management Organisation and Nature Scot, we have signed that joint interim position statement, which sets out our collective position. Put simply, Presiding Officer, that position is that low-noise alternatives should be prioritised over higher-order detonations. However, clearly, as contributions have made clear today, these are serious matters with substantial safety and environmental implications. Moreover, alternatives to high-order detonation are a relatively new approach in a commercial context, And because of these two factors, we have to be sure that they are effective and that they are safe. Now, early trials of low-order deflagration techniques show that it can result in much reduced underwater noise, which brings obvious benefits for acoustic impacts on marine wildlife. Further trials of techniques have taken place off the coast of Denmark. These trials commenced on the 22nd of January this year after a slight delay owing to COVID, and six World War II mines have been cleared. Measurements were taken at a range of distances during this project to characterise sound outputs, and seabed and surface samples were also collected. And I'm particularly interested in the findings of this report because, importantly, they took place in North Sea conditions and have a really strong applicability for us in that regard. The data from this trial is currently being analysed by scientists and will be made available as soon as possible. And, of course, when that information is made available, it will inform our decision-making and decision-making across the UK, I expect, on alternative technologies. But beyond the scientific research that I've just outlined, the Scottish Government takes an active role in developing an evidence base to ensure that best available science will always underpin the planning and regulation of developments which are contributing to our low-carbon future, but are doing so in a sensitive environment which we must protect. And our Scottish Marine Energy Research Programme is playing a significant part of that. We also operate an array of acoustic readers across the east coast of Scotland, which for almost a decade have been measuring underwater noise before and during offshore wind farm construction. I'm glad that the motion highlights and that members have asked for a call for new guidance from Marine Scotland. I'm pleased to say that a review of our current consenting and licensing guidance for offshore renewable energy is being undertaken, and the updated guidance will reinforce our position surrounding that effort to reduce underwater noise levels. But mindful of time, Presiding Officer, in conclusion, the Government is committed to ensuring that the deployment of Scotland's huge offshore wind potential materialises in a way which is sustainable and respects the marine environment and which crucially is safe to those people working in our marine environment. Our ongoing evidence-based collaborative work, including with regulators and nature conservation bodies, will help us deliver this. We have a robust framework which already prioritises low-impact clearance of UXO, and we are committed to considering evidence of new techniques as they emerge, always being sure that they are effective, safe and as unobtrusive in our environment as possible. Thanks.
Thank you very much indeed, Minister. That concludes the debate, and I close this meeting of Parliament.